الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا، أما بعد. Last week we began speaking about, and as I mentioned last week, the topic is very difficult to mention. And whatever I'm saying from the front is nothing that has been mentioned clearly in Quran and Hadith. Therefore, if history proves it wrong, nothing of Quran and Hadith has been proved wrong. It is an understanding which certain people have taken from the indications of Quran and Hadith. We spoke about the Jews or the Bani Israel in the Mubarak land of Baytul Muqaddas. And for a few minutes we will just revise that so that everyone is again brought into the picture. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala had always promised this land, which is called the Muqaddas land, the Mubarak land, to those people who will be a people of deen. And for a great many years it was always the children of Israel, Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam. And thereafter, when their evil reached certain levels, that the Anbiya alayhimus salatu wasalam who came to them warned them that if you don't stop, then this Mubarak land will be taken away once and for all. And they never listened. They had enjoyed a time when Sulaiman alayhi salam was ruler, Dawood alayhi salam was ruler, they ruled the world. Whatever was around them, they had complete power. And as time passed and they began falling into evil and pride overtook them that nothing can happen to us, and Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala finally sends a king from Babylon, who the Arabs would know as Bukht-e-Nasr. And he attacks them with such severity that the entire masjid is taken to the ground. And every person who's left alive from the family of Israel is then taken away to Babylon. The Nabi of the time had promised them that Allah's punishment will come in such a way that for about 70 years you will remain in exile. And exactly how he said 70 years, 70 years later, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala sends a king from Persia, who the Arabs then called Cyrus. And he felt pity on the Bani Israel, and he attacks the Babylonian king. He destroys his empire, and thereafter he allows the Jews to all return back to the Mubarak land. The Jews had complete control over Al-Quds until that time. When Cyrus took over, he allowed them to return to the land, but the condition was Baytul Muqaddas and that land will remain under the Persian rule. From that time onwards, Jews never ever got control over the Mubarak land. So they enjoyed a great period of time, and the king Cyrus, he allowed whatever money they want, they can use, they can build again the masjid, but it must remain under Persian rule. And they enjoyed that time. They found one promise in the scriptures, however, that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will send to them three people. One is the Masih, one is what they call Elias, and one is the Prophet. And when the Prophet will come, then that will be the time when they will once again be able to take complete control over this land. So even in the time of the Persians, when they were enjoying that living there, they were still waiting for that Prophet to come. That even the Persians can go out and we must take control. Nabi Yahya alayhi salatu wasalam came and he began giving them da'wah. And he pulled a great crowd amongst them. And he told them to turn away from their evil ways, come back to the new ways. So they asked him the question, are you the Masih? And they were referring to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. So he replied, I'm not the Masih. Thereafter they asked him, are you Elias? So he replied that he is not Elias. I myself am not sure who Elias will be or who he was. And thereafter they asked him, are you the Prophet? And he replied, I'm not the Prophet. So the people said, then what we got to do with you? We want the Prophet. Because when the Prophet will come, we will take over everything again. This Prophet that they were looking at, the way they mentioned to him, the Prophet, they never even mentioned his name as though they knew this man already. When Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Medina Munawwara, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala revealed verses of Quran that the Jews recognize Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more better than a father recognizes his own son. To such an extent they had the sifat and the qualities of the Prophet. For 500 plus years they waited for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to come. When he finally came, that jealousy overtook them, that why from the family of Ismail alayhi salam and not Ishaq? And they said, we'll never accept it. So Yahya alayhi salatu wasalam gave them dawah, and something happened in his time. The king of the area then had him killed, his head was taken, severed. And the Jews of the time never rebelled. Many of them said, well, it's good. He was always speaking too much. Zakariya alayhi salatu wasalam was murdered. And thereafter they tried to murder Isa alayhi salatu wasalam when he began speaking against them. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala lifted Isa alayhi salatu wasalam up, but before he went, he told them that Allah's second punishment will now come to you. Throughout history, the Jews were punished many times. But it was these two times which are mentioned in the Quran that their entire identity was lost. The first time when they were destroyed by the Babylonian king, every scripture of theirs was burnt. That's why Uzair alayhi salatu wasalam from memory had to rewrite the Torah for them. So their identity was lost completely the first. And our time was coming, the second time, when their identity as a nation will be lost again. And that happened when the Roman leader Titus, he attacked. And to such an extent, he had them massacred, that according to their numbers, and in their numbers there's always exaggeration, but in their numbers they say over 1 million were killed. Over 90,000 were sent as slaves to Egypt and other parts of the world. Completely destroyed. And this Roman Empire thereafter took over, and shortly afterwards the Romans became Christians. And between Christians and the Jews there was always that hatred, because the Christians realized that the Jews were the ones who killed our Nabi. So the Christians made sure the Jews never ever come back in that land, and they remained. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala then, all, as we mentioned in their scriptures, the promise was given, when the Prophet will come, it will be your last chance. When Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thereafter came and he gave them da'wah, before making hijrah to Medina Munawwara, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala took him for Mi'raj. And on the Mi'raj journey, the interesting part was that he had to stop over at Baytul Muqaddas. And he had to make imamat of all the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Jews were thereafter informed of this, that this Nabi claims that he went to this masjid. This was that indication to them that this is the Nabi of Masjid Al-Aqsa. And now you've got the chance. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the hijrat, he faced Baytul Muqaddas for about 17 months, inviting them over, that I am that last Nabi you're waiting for. And when Allah tabarak wa ta'ala then saw that they're not accepting, thereafter the door closed upon them as a whole. That now the Jews will never ever return to that height of getting their own sovereign state. And history has shown they never got it after that. So that's what we mentioned previously. Thereafter we explained that now when the Jews started returning to Israel in recent history, then people began wondering that where has this started happening from. So in the ahadith there was an indication which was clear. When Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned that Dajjal will have followers of the Jews just from one area over 70,000. Just from one area. Whereas at the time when he mentioned it, there were no Jews living in that area. So the indication was given, before the end of time the Jews will have to start moving over to that land. And then we mentioned that if in Quran we have to look for an indication, in Quran you will find nothing clear about the Jews coming back to Israel. But if you want to find an indication perhaps, then in this verse, وَحَرَامٌ عَلَىٰ قَرْيَةٍ أَهْلَكْنَاهَا, we will find it. The verse which Mufassirin have explained means that whoever Allah has destroyed will never ever come back alive until the opening of Ya'juj Ma'juj. Mufassirin explained it like this, that whoever has been destroyed will never come alive until Qiyamah. And when Qiyamah will take place, then everyone will come alive and the Hisab will take place. If, however, this word Qarya is taken to mean the land of Baytul Muqaddas, Palestine, and that area around it, and this is only an indication, it might be wrong, it might be right, Mufassirin of the past have never mentioned this. But if it is taken to mean Palestine, then it will mean that the Qarya which was destroyed by Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, meaning the Jews which were exiled, will never now get the chance to come back as a ruling force to Israel until a time comes when they are supported by the might of the Ya'juj Ma'juj. And that's where we ended. So the question then came, and many people asked about the Yajuj Majuj, and now we will go into the Siyam. That couple of things we have to understand of the Yajuj Majuj. Number one is, we have all an idea in the back of our mind that the Yajuj Majuj are a nation which looks like aliens, which have been locked behind one wall. The ulama have mentioned that all those narrations which mention any quality of the Yajuj Majuj, which make them seem that they are not like us human, all those narrations are extremely weak and cannot be relied upon. The Yajuj Majuj are like me and you. That's the first thing. The second thing is, Yajuj Majuj is a nation which we mentioned their numbers will be such that Tabi'in mentioned of the world, if it's divided into 10 parts, 9 parts will be of the Yajuj Majuj, 1 part will be of the rest. So if you go into the discussion of who is Yajuj Majuj, you rather go into the discussion of who is not Yajuj Majuj. Because if 9 parts of the known world are from that progeny, then that one part which is not from the progeny is the lucky part. And the only people most likely we can say that they are not from that progeny will be the Arabs. Because Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's lineage was traced right till Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. And although there's no complete conviction in that lineage, but that lineage shows that the Yajuj Majuj did not feature anywhere in that chain. Everywhere else there's a possibility you could be from that progeny. It could be the Indian, it could be the black, it could be the European, it could be the Russian, it could be the German. And it makes no difference whoever it is. It's just that throughout history they will be there. That's the second point. The third point is Dhulqarnain, when he came, he was asked to attack a group of the Yajuj Majuj, which he did. And he put up a barrier between them and the people who they were invading. That barrier of his, what has happened to it, is a thing that history will then show. Whether that group is still behind that barrier, whether some have gone over the mountain, some have gone past the waters, whether the wall has broken, the wall has not broken, before Isa alayhi salatu wasalam's time, that wall will finally be broken. That is a thing of history. But that does not mean that Dhulqarnain gathered the entire Yajuj Majuj of around the world and put them behind that one wall. They have been around the world, one group was there, and he locked them up behind that. That is the third. And the fourth thing which Allama Anwar Shah Kashmiri Rahimullah thereafter mentioned, that to mention who is Yajuj Majuj and to point a finger at anyone and say you are from them will not be right. Because this has now become a label which is derogatory. People regard it as a name of people who are like animals. So he said throughout history, to work out who is from that progeny, that is obviously, as I mentioned, very hard. He explained the only way we will be able to say someone is from the Yajuj Majuj or not will be to look at those sifat which Quran have mentioned or which the ahadith have mentioned. Where those sifat are found on a nation, then that name can be placed on them. When that nation loses those qualities, that name will be removed from them. And throughout history, it will not be hard then to pick up people who could have been the Yajuj Majuj of the times. Although progeny wise, many others could have been. But with sifat and qualities, couple of them. At a certain time in Islam, when the Tatars invaded the Muslim worlds, majority of the ulama at that time said, this is definitely one group of them. The way they massacred the Muslims. And thereafter they accepted Islam, what they're accepting Islam, the name had to be removed. When the Soviet Union came into place and went through the Muslim worlds, I don't think at that time there was any doubt in anyone that these people have that qualities. Where they massacred the Muslims to such an extent that to find a Muslim after that in those lands became practically impossible. When the Christian crusaders went into Baytul Muqaddas and they killed by the thousands, then many Christians even said, these people are not Christians. That in our holy land doing such actions. When America invaded what they called the New World, when Europeans went over, then we all know that there were people called Red Indians living in that land. What happened to those Red Indians? They were wiped out to such an extent that you'll have to go and look and ask that, do you know anything of any Red Indian? And maybe someone might be able to say, I should be from that lineage of the Red Indians. But there's no Red Indians left. So when these qualities are found in a person, Mawlana Anwar Shah Kashmiri Rahimullah then mentioned qualities. The first one is Mufsiduna fil ard. He explains Mufsiduna fil ard, that they will have the certain qualities. The first one is Ihlaqun Nasal. Such a nation whose love is to destroy people and their progenies completely. He said it will not be soldiers whose job will to be fight a war against soldiers, men against men. It will be people who will wage war, will not only kill the men, they will make sure they massacre the women and the children also. Ihlaqul nasl. Then he said, Ihlaqul harth. They will leave that land also completely devastated. The third thing he says, Takhribul bilad. Whatever buildings they find in that area, they will bring it to the ground. As though we don't want any sign of you people left. Another alim writes that certain indications can be taken from Quran regarding the qualities of Ya'juj Ma'juj. He says when Zulqarnain came, then certain things Quran mentioned regarding him, making an indication that the Ya'juj Ma'juj have the opposite of his qualities. One of those qualities was Zulqarnain mentioned that person who is wrong, amma man zalama, that person who is an oppressor, I will fight against him. Wa amma man amana, and that person who is good, I will leave that person. They said, as though indication is being made, the Ya'juj Ma'juj are the opposite. That those people who will be good in every time, their war will be on those people. And those people who will be people of evil, they will be left one side. The second quality of Zulqarnain, when he came upon primitive people, and he found that they could not speak his language also, he left them. He says, this group of the Ya'juj Ma'juj, wherever they attack, if they find primitive people, they'll never leave them. They will make sure you all either become like us or you all are destroyed. We will never leave you and your land. And he says the third thing is that when Zulqarnain put up that wall and he said that this is هذا رحمة من ربي, he showed that whatever kamal and achievement I have done, it is because of my creator. The Ya'juj Ma'juj will be that nation, whatever kamal and whatever deed they do, splendor they do, they will never say it is because of the help of God. They will always attribute it to some other power. Now throughout history, if you have these qualities in front of you, at different times in history, you can always work out the different groups of Ya'juj, Ma'juj sprouted up every time. And definitely in the time of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, after the Jews will all be destroyed by the Muslims, and after the Christians, whoever are left alive, will accept Islam, then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will then reveal to him that the scum of the earth will now be left open. When that scum of the world is left open, it could be those behind that wall with Zulqarnain locked up, and from the rest of the world, obviously, also, that entire force will gather to fight against the Muslims. That will be that force which Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will then tell the Muslims, you cannot fight these people. He will take his followers to the mountain, and Muslims around the world will be told that you must go now and put yourselves closed up. They will take protection in forts, they will take protection in homes, no one will come out. And when this force then spreads throughout the world, and they find that there is no one ready to fight against them, then they will say, we have killed everyone on the earth, now it's only the person left in the sky. After Allah tabarak wa ta'ala then destroys this group of the Ya'juj Ma'juj, and Isa alayhi salatu wasalam finally comes down. In the hadith it is mentioned, from that time onwards, besides Islam, there will be nothing left on the surface of the earth. Meaning every religion besides Islam will be wiped out completely. So wherever an atheist has to be living, he will also be in that punishment which the Ya'juj Ma'juj will be hit. Most likely because he is part of that Ya'juj Ma'juj. Around the world there will be no atheists left. There will be no Buddhists left. There will be no idol worshipper left. It will be Islam and only Islam throughout. So that final scum of the world which will be let out will not be from one wall, but from all over wherever they are, they will fall on the Muslims and they will be entirely destroyed. So that is the thing to understand of the Ya'juj Ma'juj. Now coming back to the topic which we started, we came to this point that if the indication in Quran is correct, the indication that we are taking, that this nation of the Jews will never return to the land of Baytul Muqaddas until a group of the Ya'juj Ma'juj will be given strength to allow them to bring them back. So the question is, we have to look in history that which group was used for this work. The Ya'juj Ma'juj throughout history, but which group from them was used for this work? And even if they are not from the Ya'juj Ma'juj, the question we are bringing, which group was responsible for bringing the Jews back to Israel? So history answers that question very well. And it teaches us something, an indication that which group is being used. Throughout history, the Jews were only helped by the European nation. It began with England, when the Europe suddenly came out of darkness. Then one island, one small land, Britain put up its head, and they began calling themselves the nation of the world, leader of the world. And they showed such strength in the world that they really, a small area was able to take over majority of what we call then the known world. During that time, Britain, which was a Christian land, so to say, they began showing a strange obsession with the Holy Land. Many years before, the Crusaders also showed it. They were also Christian. They wanted that Holy Land, whereas the Byzantine Christians had nothing to do with it. But when Britain began showing this desire of the Holy Land, it was completely different. The Crusaders wanted the Holy Land for themselves. When Britain's obsession with the Holy Land came out, it was not for us, but it was that our worst enemies, the Jews, can get this land. Christians and Jews had forever been enemies. From the time the Jews said that we kill your God, or we kill your Nabi. But suddenly Britain made such an embrace with the Jewish Europeans. That embrace has lasted up till today. And they made the effort that we will make sure you people will get your land. So Europe for many years, Britain, continued with the struggle to make sure the land of Israel then goes to the Jews. In about 1956 or so, many things happened in the world. One of those things was that Britain was now no longer regarded as the ruling country of the world. Everything then shifted to America. With the shifting, the first was London was no longer regarded as the capital international market of the world. It went to Washington. The pound, which for many years had been regarded as the currency of the world, was now switched to the dollar. Britain kept their status, but no longer as a leading power of the world. Everything switched over to America. And with the switching over of all that power to America, a new obsession switched over to America. Britain, the final time they had with Israel was when Israel attacked Egypt, trying to get possession of the Suez Canal. At that time, America came in and told Britain, you take your troops out. And Israel soldiers go out. And then Britain finally was forced by America to move out. From that time onwards, Britain showed that no country in the world has the job of looking after Israel, it is our job. And from that time, no one has ever spoken in defense of Israel unless first America gives the go-ahead. From that time onwards, America showed their obsession with Israel. One of the obsessions is that so much of aid is being given to Israel that compared to the aid America gives to the rest of the world, the aid it gives Israel is far more. The second thing is America has risked its own reputation as a leading power of the world just to make sure Israel's work is done. Whether the world will criticize them, they don't worry. Whether their own soldiers have to die in battle, they're not interested. Just to make sure Israel remains safe from the Muslim world or the world around, they will sacrifice everything for who? They are Christian, so to say. But for those people who are supposed to be their worst enemies, the Jews. As though they have been chosen for this work. And until today, when 9/11 took place, just before that, the United Nations asked Israel that you are going too much in your endeavors against the Palestinians, so you have to stop. Only two countries did not accept what the UN said and walked out of that meeting. One was Israel themselves, obviously, they never accepted. And the other one was the USA. They said, we will never accept. What does America have to do with Israel? What benefit do they get from it? So history shows us that a European nation has been chosen in the last period of time for the work of bringing the Jews back to Israel. Why have they been chosen? Either you can say that they are a group of the Yajuj Majuj which has been chosen for this work. Or if they are not a group of the Yajuj Majuj, then we'll just say Taqdeer has chosen them for this work. But history proves this point. That the Europeans have regarded themselves as the chosen nation for the work of Israel. Although they do not claim that we are Jews. So the question that will come now, and which I leave you all to think about, is why have they been chosen? Why have they taken this work that we will make sure the Jews come back to Israel? And not only they have taken the work that it's our work, but they took it in stages. As long as Britain remained the world force, they took it as their work. When America became the world force, they took it as our work. That you don't get involved now. You will listen to us, but you don't get involved. It is our work. So what is spurring them on to tell them that you all must take this work as your goal in life, your ambition, and for it sacrifice everything you got? obviously they got no scriptures that say that if you will go and save the Holy Land, you're going to get Jannah. They are not getting any money out of Israel. Rather, they are putting more money into Israel. So what is spurring them on to lose their soldiers, to lose their reputation, to lose everything, just to make sure Israel can be established? So that is one question which I will leave you people until next time I speak. The second question which I will give an answer is, which country poses the greatest threat to Israel? So many times when this question is brought, we will think of some Arab country. We might think of Iraq, we might think of Iran, a power which is so powerful that can just blow them from the surface of the earth. Which country poses the greatest threat to Israel? So recently when the new president was elected, then he made one statement that had me wondering. He said that in the coming year now, when he becomes president, he will make sure that slowly all American soldiers will be pulled out of Iraq. And thereafter he said a very amazing thing. However, regarding Afghanistan, we're going to increase our troops. Whereas if you look logical, Iraq is a greater danger for Israel and the area around, like Iran, who got weapons who can really blow them off the surface of the earth. Whereas Afghanistan is such an area that even if they want to send one missile, which they most likely don't have, I don't think it's going to reach Israel. What fear is there in Afghanistan that America will have to now increase their troops before Israel goes on to its next mission? So that's what I was wondering about until I saw that hadith, which in Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned, that in the end of time when you will see black flags rising from Khurasan, when you will see black flags rising from Khurasan, Khurasan is divided into a couple of areas, but the main area of Khurasan is Afghanistan itself. A part of Pakistan will also be included, a part of Iran will also be included. But the main area is Afghanistan itself. Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, when you will see black flags rising from Khurasan, then he said, go towards that land, no matter how hard it is, even if you have to slide on ice. In another hadith he mentioned, because in them will be Allah's promised Masih. Not Masih, Allah's promised what you call messenger, what will be what we call Hazrat Mahdi. And thereafter he mentioned at the end of the narration that when this group finally stands up and that flags rise, then no nation in the world will be able to stop them until they will go all the way to Baitul Muqaddas and take over. So this is the greatest threat over Israel. So as everyone's attention is now focused on the land of Gaza and the land of Palestine, also keep our attention of what's happening presently in Afghanistan. How are the Muslims rising there? What strength are they getting day by day? And when Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala makes it that that group will be able to stand up completely, and when Western powers will have to completely come out of that land, then inshallah at that time we will see things which will be the coolness of our eyes. So while our eyes are focused on Gaza itself, our eyes must be there also. While our du'as are for the people of Palestine, it must continue going for the people of Afghanistan. Because in the light of ahadith, the greatest hope the people of Baitul Muqaddas have is not from the Arabs around them. Rather, it's from those people of Afghanistan. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala make that what I say not all just be. Shouldn't be wrong. History should inshallah prove very, very quickly. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala should make it that in our own lives, our eyes can be cooled. And we can see such things happening that will bring happiness to all of us.